study camp. I was born in Germany, which was not a very advantageous thing for me, because being born in having been born in Germany, Hitler started in Germany, and we were the ones who got it first. So in 1933, I was 12 years old, and Hitler started his rampage in the smaller towns much earlier than in the big cities. And in the smaller towns, every each other. And stormtroopers were specially educated and sent into the small towns to teach the population how to annoy the Jews in the town. So right from 1933 on, they came into our town, they threw us, we had a little parochial school of Jewish children, they closed the school, we had to go to the public school, which was no tragedy, but there we were singled out every single day. And as I'm going along in my story about why it was not good to be in a public school in those days. So I will go now to the beginning of my story, but I guess I will sit down. I will tell you a little bit of the beginning of my odyssey through the Hitler era. True, one forgets a lot of things in a period of from 1933 to 2000. 67 years, it's a long time. But a lot of horrible things I remember. I was born and lived until the age of 12 in a small farming village in Germany. The village had 1,200 residents. 100 of these people were Jewish. Jews and Gentiles and all the people in town lived harmoniously side by side, and we lived a very comfortable life until Hitler came. He became chancellor in January of 1933. Early on in that year, the Nazi brown shirts were sent to our little town to agitate the population of the village against the Jews. Public school teachers, although they had been friends of the Jewish families, became vicious anti-Semites. We, the Jewish children, had to sit in the classrooms and listen as the teacher preached that Jews root of all the evil that had befallen Germany, and that they must be done away with. Can you all hear me?
Yeah.
We were even forced to participate in the most hateful anti-Semitic songs, like in German, Köpfe rollen, Juden heulen, which means heads are rolling, Jews are howling. Children are easily misled, and they constantly harassed and physically assaulted us. In sewing class, the teacher, a Miss Schotte, instigated the girls to stick needles into my body. Another teacher, a Mr. Weitling, hung Jewish youngsters by their feet on trees and let them dangle for the amusement of the others. On another occasion, this same teacher took the young Jewish children to the public swimming pool and dumped them into the deep end of the water. None of these children could swim. The other children were told to use them as dummies for life-saving. They themselves couldn't swim. When they were finally pulled out of the water, they were barely alive. My brother was one of those children. Having been subjected to constant stress and aggravation, my father died of a heart attack in May of 1935 at the age of 49. Between the years of 1935 and 1940, Many Jews were able to emigrate from Germany, and I have often been asked, why did you stay there? It was a simple reason. We didn't have the money to purchase passage to South America, mainly to the South American countries, because most countries wouldn't accept Jews. So being we didn't have the money, we couldn't go. We had to stay there, and we had to endure what they dished out to us. 1938, I will never forget November 9th, 1938, the Kristallnacht, known as the Night of the Broken Glass. Synagogues were destroyed, Jewish store windows were smashed, and the stores were looted. Private homes were ransacked, and furniture and valuables were carted away. 30,000 Jews in Germany were arrested, and many, many brutalized. The next day, November the 10th, Jews fled their little towns with whatever they could carry of their belongings, seeking shelter in the cities. My family, too, had to leave our home. At the time, I was doing forced domestic labor in a home for the aged in Frankfurt. 4 o'clock in the morning, responding to frantic banging on the door, I was shocked beyond belief when I saw my mother and an uncle bedraggled and frozen with fright. My uncle was bleeding profusely. He had been beaten beyond recognition. November the 9th, 1938, was thus the beginning of the systematic annihilation of Jews in Germany. I'd just like to ask you one question. Have you ever looked up the word Holocaust in a dictionary? The word Holocaust simply means total destruction by fire. And it was adopted for the slaughter of the 6 million Jews after the war. September the 24th, 1942 will always be vivid in my mind. That day, my mother, sister, myself, and hundreds of others were deported from the city of Frankfurt, Germany. SS men were strutting and cursing. They shoved us into railroad cars. And as we were herded into the train, an unconscious woman with horrible red welts around her neck was brought on a stretcher and shoved in the train. She had hung herself, but her heart was still beating faintly when the Nazis came to her apartment to pick her up. Almost dead, she too could not escape deportation. She died on that train. Nobody can tell me that the German people or the world at large did not know her horrible fate. As this macabre spectacle at the railroad depot in Frankfurt unfolded, hundreds of German civilians were standing on an overpass watching it all. On that horrible journey into the unknown, I sat squeezed onto a seat next to a young nursing mother. Her infant was whimpering incessantly until he could whimper no more. Since we had no food and hardly any water for days, this mother could not feed her child, and he, with many others on that train, died. After many days on this nightmare trip, we arrived in a desolate place called Razaku, located somewhere north of the town in Estonia. We were ordered to get off the train, and the life and death selections began. Out of the approximately 1,200 people on that train, 100 young women and 70 men were selected to stay alive for the time being to do hard physical labor. My mother and sister were torn away from me to be killed. We later learned that the peculiar looking windowless buses they were shoved into were mobile gas chambers. Thus, my mother, my sister, my friends, and my community were exterminated by asphyxiation. We, the 100 young women, were brought to a camp called Yegala. Our sleeping quarter was a wooden barrack without glass in the window. Our beds were tiers of wooden planks. There were no blankets for us. By now, it was October and very, very cold in Estonia, and we were freezing. Our first job was to unpack and assort the bundles and bags of the people who were on the same transport with us, but now dead. Thus, coats, shoes, whatever they had with them, were ready to be shipped back to Germany to be used by the German people. We also had to chop down ice-covered trees to make better access roads for the next shipment of Jews. After about 1 month in Jägala, we were brought to an ancient jail in the city of Tallinn. From that jail, we were escorted every morning by submachine gun-toting guards to our slave labor workplace, the bombed-out harbor of Tallinn. During the winter months, in sub-zero weather, we had to clean the debris from the bombed-out buildings and scrape the mortar of the old fallen bricks. We also had to carry 100-pound bags of lime and cement to the work site, all in preparation for our next job. Lime is a very caustic substance, and since we did not have the necessary clothing to protect us from the substance, we suffered burns constantly. When the weather permitted, to mix cement, we were forced to become bricklayers. We spent 2 years in 5 different slave labs in Estonia, where we were physically forced to work very hard. We were always hungry, we were always cold, and we were terrified, and we felt totally abandoned by the so-called civilized world. While in Estonia, and this is a very gruesome story I'm telling you now, babies were born to some of our young women who had come away from home being pregnant. Nurses among us, these nurses were nurses that were deported from Frankfurt with us. They were forced to deliver those babies and dump them head first into buckets of water. Thus, the Nazis eliminated another generation of Jews. The weak and the sick periodically picked out from our group and sent to their death. In 1944, it became apparent that the Germans were losing the war in Russia. And once again, we had to be moved, but this time they moved us back into Germany. They didn't want us to be taken over by the Russians that were coming on. Still fairly healthy women from various camps in Estonia were brought to the outskirts of Tallinn. There we spent 3 weeks on an open field without shelter until a boat for our trip across the Baltic Sea became available. When they had moved us to that town, there was a boat there for that we should board and go back to Germany on, but the army needed that boat and know what to do with it. So they just brought us to an open meadow, and that was our camp, and that's where we stayed, and whoever couldn't go on and got an injection to just die right, to be killed right there, or was just left on the field. Eventually we got onto a boat. Once again, we had to be moved, this time back to Germany. The still fairly healthy women from various camps in Estonia were brought to the outskirts of town. We spent 3 weeks on an open field without shelter. During this time, the once unable to continue slave labor were slaughtered right on that field. Finally, we were herded into a boat, standing room only. It took 3 days to cross the Baltic Sea, and it was 3 days without water and only one slice of bread per day. It was 3 days without any sanitation facilities. We finally arrived in the concentration camp of Stutthof in Germany. Weak, tired, and dirty, we had to stand roll call for endless hours. Whoever fainted was revived with a bucket of cold water over his head. One day, we had to totally undress, climb under stools, and SS men, not doctors, just plain SS men, examined us internally, supposedly looking for valuables. Then they shaved our heads and all our body hair. After 3 weeks in Stutthof, which was a virtual hell on earth, 500 of us were selected for slave labor in an ammunition factory. Once again, we were shoved onto a train and arrived days later in a labor camp called Neuengamme Ochsensau, which was not far from Hamburg, Germany. After about 7 months in Neuengamme, the air raid sirens were heard many times a day, and we could hear the reverberating gun battles close by, and we knew if we could hold on just a little bit longer, we would survive and we would be able to tell the world what was done to us and what was done to the people that were killed. But once again, the Germans had to torture us a little more. This time, they transported us to the Bergen-Belsen concentration camp. The last few miles to the camp, we had to walk, and whoever was too weak was shot and was left by the side of the road. Adequate to describe the condition in Bergen-Belsen simply do not exist. 10,000 dead bodies and thousands of dying people were laying in the walkways. They were laying on the faeces-covered sleeping planks, and dead bodies were floating in the pond, the only drinking water of the camp. We, the latest arrivals, were forced to drag these dead and dying people and stack them up like cordwood. I can still hear the moans of a dying person as four of us had to each take an arm or a leg and move these people to the already high piles of lost humanity. Not everybody was dead that was piled up on that pile. They were gonna die, but they weren't dead yet. I will never forget searching the faces of the dead and the walking skeletons for someone I might have once known. And I still see the survivors sick with typhus, too weak to walk, trying to help each other to get to the so-called latrine. 40,000 people were liberated in Bergen-Belsen on April the 15th, 1945. For 28,000 of those, liberation came too late. They died short of being freed. I would like to add one pertinent factor. Not only Jews were killed and annihilated, millions of other people, the mentally retarded, were the first ones to be killed. Nuns and priests got killed. People with politically different views and many, many others were killed during the Nazi rampage of Germany. Naturally, I cannot tell you too much in a few minutes of talk. Whatever you want to ask me, I'll be happy to answer as good as I can.
Have you been back to Germany since?
Yes. I went back to Germany several times. In the beginning, to look in the small towns for survivors of people that I had once known. The last 2 years ago, I was invited by the city of Frankfurt and by the Fritz Bauer Institute to come and make a video for the purpose of education for the young people in Germany, especially for teacher education. Teachers were then going to use it. So I went back, and they walked me through. It was a huge huge hall where vegetables and fruits were sold. That was the last of our nights in Germany. They walked me through this place. And while walking through, I had to tell them exactly what I could remember, what had happened there. And then I also went to a class, and I talked to youngsters in a classroom. And a very peculiar thing happened to me. Whenever I speak in a classroom in America, students ask questions. The school in Germany I went to, not one question was asked of me. The only thing I could attribute to, I think I shocked them so much. They had not known what their fathers and grandfathers had done to the Jews of that country and the Jews of Europe. They were actually stunned. Sure, you can read in a book what happened during the Nazi era, but when you hear it from a person that lived through it, it's an entirely different story. And those students, they were sick. Absolutely sick. I could not take that question.
Sir. How did you arrive in the United States?
That is a very, very good story. Have you heard of kinder transports? These were transports of young children that were taken out of Germany and put into a safe haven, into England, into other European countries were all doomed, except for England. But I hate to tell you that the United States closed its doors and did not let a child or anybody come in. Until finally, Mrs. Roosevelt persuaded her husband, there was a bunch of kids in the southern part of France living in the Vichy government that must be taken out there before they got killed. And this is my brother's story. My brother left Germany with a kinder transport at age 13. They went to France and they lived in one of Rothschild's mansions. There was an organization in Paris called the Osei. This organization got many children out of Germany and they took care of them while they lived in France. They taught them trades. My brother became a carpenter. Other children became brick masons, painters, whatever. The children learned a trade there. And then when the Germans overran Paris, these children went on a train, they went on buses, they went on ox carts, they walked. They finally came to the southern part of France, where the Germans didn't have the government, but the Vichy government was cooperating with the German government. So in order to save these children, the head of this organization begged the United States, take the children, please let these children survive. But finally, Eleanor Roosevelt persuaded Franklin that a transport of children could come to the United States. And the American Quakers from Pennsylvania, they underwrote the mission. They paid for the passage. They brought it to New York. While in New York, my brother met a cousin, and they got in touch with other relatives in Shreveport, Louisiana, who adopted my brother. Meantime, he became 18 years old, and he volunteered in the American Air Force. And that was just the time when we were liberated in Bergen-Belsen. And I went to an American reporter all the year, from every kind of reporters came to the camp, and I went to an American reporter, and I told him that I had a brother in the United States, and I told him, I presumed he was in Shreveport, Louisiana, I wasn't sure. So the next day, the names of the survivors were broadcast in the United States in the newspapers, on radios. There was no television in those days. So my brother was out, he was in this Air Force camp, and the people in Shreveport heard on the radio that a sister of his was liberated. And at the time, he was supposed to be shipped with the American forces to Japan. So he went to Washington, D.C., and he went to the Red Cross, he went to the Congress, and he asked everybody, please don't ship me to Japan. Ship me to Germany. I have one sister that survived this carnage. Finally, the senator from Louisiana, Senator Allender, he agreed for my brother to be moved from a transport to Japan to go to Germany. This was about a month after, maybe 2-3 months after we were liberated. And shortly after he got to the embarkation place to go to Germany, he went onto the boat, and the boat landed in Cherbourg, France. Meantime, I had gotten into Paris. Whoever could walk or could do anything, I hitchhiked into Paris, because Paris was the only American consulate in Europe. And in order for me to come to America, I had to go to an American consulate. So my brother knew that I was in Paris, but he didn't know where to find me. But he knew of an address of France. So he went to his commanding officer and he said to him, sir, I know I have a sister in Paris that survived. Please give a few hours of leave. I want to find her. And his commanding officer said, I cannot give you leave because we're shipping out to a base in Germany. So the officer said to him, but do what your conscience tells you to do. So he did. He hitchhiked into Paris from Cherbourg, and he went to the house of the people that could give a nation where I would be. And call it a miracle, or whatever you might call it. That particular day, I was babysitting for the people whom my brother went to find out where I am. And as I walked down the stairs from that house, after having babysat for these people, an American soldier walked up the stairs in that house in Paris. And I looked at this soldier. I hadn't seen my brother for 6 years or so. I looked at him and I said, Henry? Yes, it was my brother. We met in a hallway in the city of Paris. That's how I got to meet my brother after the war. Then, naturally, the papers were ready for me to come to the United States, and I got to come to the United States, but my brother had to serve his term of duty in Europe, which was fine. And after he came back to the States, we rented a place together. Yes, go ahead. No, only Auschwitz and possibly Stutthof, you got numbers. We did not get them. We were in labor in Estonia, and the Estonian people didn't know we were Jewish. And this would have given us away immediately having a number. So they played, the Germans played it very low key. We didn't wear the prisoners' uniform, the striped uniform. We were given civilian clothes because we had a march through this town all the time. And they saw there were prisoners, but they didn't know who the prisoners were. How did I know? Okay. There was total chaos in Europe. One lady lived in Switzerland. She was a friend of my mother's. And we could not send any mail to America. But this lady from Switzerland was a free country. She could come to visit Germany. She came to visit us. And through her, gave her a letter to send to my brother into France at the time. He in turn sent a letter to Switzerland telling her that he was going to go to America. And through her we found out that he was going to be in America.
Have you ever been to Holocaust
again? We're going to go next Wednesday to Washington, D.C. You've been there? It's quite wrenching, right?
Yes.
But the reason I haven't been there, I really didn't want to go there because all those things I've lived through in person, I didn't really want to see it. But I finally decided we'll go next Wednesday. Any other questions?
Did any other family members go through the concentration camps and survive?
No.
No, just you?
No. Mother, sister, cousins, uncles, aunts, everybody perished.
How many camps did you go through?
Depending on what you count, if you count a meadow for 3 weeks, then it was, if you don't count a couple of transit camps, it was 8. I was in 2 concentration camps and in 6 labor camps. I'm 79 years old now, so I lived a long time, and the stories I'm telling you, I lived through them.
Did you ever lose your faith?
That's something I can't answer because I don't know. Because at times you question yourself.
We read Night by
Wiesel.
Right. And he mentioned that he questioned himself a lot.
You have to. Otherwise, how can you live and say, was this supposed to be? No, you have to question. But you don't get an answer. Any other questions?
How old were you and your sister?
What?
How old were you and your sister?
How old? When Hitler came, I was 12 years old, and that was in 1933. Went into the concentration camp in 1942. I was 21 years old. When I came out, I was 25. Actually, not quite 25.
Was the movie Schindler's List anything like?
Well, Schindler's List is very mild, considering what we have seen.
A lot
We worked very hard, but compared to what we have lived through, it's a very mild story. For people that haven't lived through that, it's a rough story.
Have they ever seen Hitler?
No. No. That would never happen to a Jew. Besides, he lived in Berlin, and I lived in a small town, and there was no way that, none at all.
How did you manage to stay healthy
and not to live? Healthy? I had typhus, which was not quite healthy. I had TB, which was not a fun thing either. But I guess I have a very strong system. I got healthy and I survived.
Do you know of any other survivors?
Yes, I'm in touch with friends, about 6-7 of us. A few of them have died over the years, but 6-7 of us are still around, and we are in touch by phone and by letters, and we visit with each other, yes. But these were all very young girls. By now they're all in their mid to late 70s. Any other questions? So they had to give us a little bit more to eat than we really did this kind of work.
Were you ever placed in a camp that had a crematory in it?
Where else was I ever?
Were you ever placed in a camp that had a crematory in it?
Was I ever paid in a camp?
Placed. Put in a camp that had a crematory in it?
No.
You never saw them?
No. At the crematorium, you see, but yes, I did see them in Auschwitz, but we only stayed there for a very few days because they shipped us out into labor camps. Anybody that could produce some labor for them was shipped out and put into ammunition factories or other factories.
Did you have any special belongings that you were able to keep with you?
Personal belongings through the camps?
Yeah.
You couldn't hide anything. No. I did get some pictures after from people that saved them from me and from my brother who had some pictures, but you couldn't have anything. You couldn't have a ring or you couldn't, nothing, absolutely nothing.
Did you ever think of trying to escape?
There was no way. We were in a harbor in Estonia, and across the town of Reval, the town of Helsinki, we could see actually the outlines of the town of Helsinki, which is Finland. Finland was still a free country, but when we started work in that camp in Reval, or Tallinn, whichever, the name changed from Reval to Tallinn, now it's Tallinn, it used to be Reval. When we started work in that camp, one of the masters of the company, one of the big shots from the company was the Philip Holtzman Company, one of the biggest building firms in Europe. The foreman, whatever he was, he came and he told us right away, if you ever try or think of escaping, you'll be shot immediately. So we knew, even if we tried, if we would get a boat, we would be captured in the middle of the water and we would be killed. There was no way to escape. This was the only place we could have escaped from. But again, from a regular camp, you couldn't escape.
What was the kind of food that you got?
Kind of food?
Yeah, it was like mush.
You got a bowl of something that was called soup. It was probably a turnip or something that sailed through it. And a slice of bread that was baked out of sawdust, maybe some flour mixed with sawdust, yeah? Mm-hmm. At one time, we were in a jail, and we lived in this old jail in the town of Tallinn, and there was a little window in the door where they brought the food to us. They opened this little trap door, and they shoved the food in, in the morning for breakfast, so we would get a slice of bread and something that was called coffee, and a bowl of fish eyes. But we weren't that hungry that we ate fish eyes, although we were hungry, but we didn't eat it.
What was your reaction when you found out the camp was going to be liberated?
It liberated?
Yeah. How'd you feel?
Well, the British Army, the Scottish Fifth Army, came in with their tanks, and they used bullhorns, you know, these long horns to let us know. They yelled through the camp, "You are liberated. We are the British, you are liberated. But do not leave this place because it's chaos out there." There were 30,000 people, 10,000 dead bodies, and people were laying all over the place dead and dying, and Germany was devastated. So where could we go? We stayed. We stayed till the British came in and actually physically cleaned us up and nursed us back to health.
How long did that take?
How long was that in the camp?
No, how long did that take for them to get in?
To get back to, depending on the person, some people never got back to health. Some people snapped after liberation mentally. 6 months after liberation, I was in good shape. I immediately volunteered to work in the clothing shed. It was called the clothing shed, where clothes was brought in from different countries, and we helped get the people from their striped uniforms into the decent clothing, so that voluntarily after liberation.
How do you deal with it now?
How do I what?
How do you deal with your past now?
It's a very good question. For many, many years I couldn't deal with it. I did not talk. For 50 years, I'm now liberated, 55 years, I did not talk. I wouldn't tell anybody, because number one, nobody wanted to listen. It was a very, very crazy time after the war. Nobody wanted to hear what went on over there, because there was a tremendous amount of guilt feeling in the whole world, that the world let this happen. And we couldn't talk because we weren't asked. We might have talked if we would have been asked, but nobody asked us. Nobody wanted to know. So, you dealt with it in your sleep.
Do you want to tell something?
Mm-hmm.
Do you want to say something or something?
Sometimes, yes. We dreamt. We couldn't sleep, we would dream. We would dream that they were after us with guns or with whatever. And all of us dreamt for years and years. And the reason I finally talked is because this lady, Sylvia Super, you have talked to her, she came to me and she said, "It's about time that you come and you tell the world what happened, because in a few more years, nobody's going to tell you or anybody else, because we're all people by now."
Liberated, or in the past like 50 years, have you ever came face to face with one of the SS soldiers?
Have I ever come?
Like, have you ever met an SS soldier since you've been liberated?
No.
No?
No.
Yes,
one girl I knew from before, and all the rest of them I came. No, because out of the 1,200 on that train, only 100 survived for a short time, and there were maybe just the one I was friendly with, and we survived together, and she lives in New York today, and we talk on the phone all the time.
Did you guys like push each other to like stay alive? Do you like help each other? Is that your inspiration to stay alive?
Yes, yes. Some girls were able to get some extra food from a farmer when we worked outside, and whatever they brought back, we shared. We helped each other a lot. Yes.
When you went back to Germany to visit your old town, did you visit any of the, I don't know if there's markers where the camps used to be?
Yes. I visited the town I was born in. And I got the house that belonged to my parents back because I just walked into the house. It was our house. And I just told the people to get out of there real fast because it was our house.
And when was this?
In 1945, end of 45. Yes, I walked into the house and I said, we'll be out of here in 2 hours. They didn't pay for the house, they took it over. Sure, because they lived there when we were still in Germany, they rented from us. And then they just decided, well, it's their house. But they only were renters. So after the liberation, I went into the house and I said, you'll be out of here in 2 hours. And they went out. Because they knew this was not their house. Anything that belonged to a Jew was taken over by anybody.
So today, is that house full of family?
That house was so bad. My brother came over, I told you, we met my brother, and he brought coffee and cigarettes and chocolate, and we sold it in Germany, and whatever he got, we paid the mortgage, whatever was left to pay him. Take the mortgage in the house, and they eventually sold it, but we got nothing for it, because at the time there was 4 German marks to a dollar, and you got nothing. $400 for the house. Today it would be worth a fortune.
You said when you went back to Germany, you visited the sites where the camps used to be?
Yes, I did go to some barracks. In one camp, there were gravestones where 1,500 people were buried or 1,000 were buried. The mass graves. After liberation, they had to bury the people. The Germans had to come with ox carts and bicycles and whatever. And they had to clean up the mess that was left. They had to bury the people, 5,000, 10,000 in one huge grave. That's what I saw after the liberation.
You think this all happened?
A reason?
Yes.
Is there a reason to go to Uganda, or is there a reason to go to Czechoslovakia or into Yugoslavia? And is there a reason for ethnic cleansing anywhere in the world? Isn't it that humanity has never learned from their mistakes? And I don't think they'll ever will, because it's going on in the daily. They wanted to rectify this. They wanted to be friendly. They wanted to be nice. It wasn't their fault. It was their fathers, grandfathers, whoever.
Have you ever met anyone who refused to be? Have you ever met anyone that refused to be with that Holocaust?
A denier? No. But there was one at the Sonoma State University many, many years ago, and I wrote a letter to him and told him if he still doubts it, I'd be happy to talk to him. I've never met anybody. No.
Um,
Did any of the soldiers have any sympathy for you, or were they really hard on you?
Did anyone?
Did any of the soldiers?
Yeah.
Did they have any sympathy for you?
I guess they were trained not to. This was not really soldiers. They were called Einsatzgruppen, and special whole group of people that were trained to be able to kill and go home and eat dinner afterwards. They had no feelings for anybody. Sure, it could happen again. Not on that scale. I don't think so. It's been happening ever since the end of the war, all over the African countries, in Uganda, wherever you look. Look what happened in Yugoslavia now. Millions of people got killed. Sure, it happens all the time. It happens.
Café de crème. this one?
No, that's not important.
Yeah, we just put it in.
You know somebody in Ashland.
Really?
Yeah.
Yeah, you see, it's a guy. Last summer, I was driving up to Portland, and my car wiped out.
Oh, no.
Yeah, it was pretty bad. Broke my arm and had a skull fracture. I probably would have died if it hadn't been for this guy who came out of nowhere, pulled me from the burning wreck, drove me to the hospital.
Wow. What an amazing story. What was this guy's name anyway?
It was Barry. Barry Daniels.
What? That heartless creep? He is my worst enemy.
Hey, I can't have you talking that way about God.
Shut up, you idiot! He is the biggest slob, jerk, stunt,
okay, that's it. Now I'm gonna have to shoot you.
There I am, hating you!
Why, wait, no, you stay there with the lights. You cannot sit. Okay, go back. Go back.
Okay, you have to shoot you.
What?
Go nuts.
Got some chips, some butterhorn raspberries, some sourdough chips, some candy, some grapes.
Sourdough chips? Yeah. Wait, Dylan is in front.
You want?
Oh, yeah, baby.
Shmear and mini shmear.
I know.
I would like to just, you know what I'm going to do? You know what I think? I'm going to just drive around the, what?
He didn't want these hours to be on
both sides. I think they're pretty good.
But he thought you had a boyfriend.
You know what? I think I'm going to just drive around and back in.
Yeah, and he told her to call me. Tell her to call me.
He's the one who, he was the one who's like,
we have to go to
where? Yeah.
Cedar Street.
Oh my god!
Okay.
And he was totally in there, and got his adult at like 7:30 in hunger, my mom times
it. You want the kids to get out while you practice?
Saturday.
So I want you to come. But it's like it's.
You know, Dylan is filming this entire trip.
He's adorable.
He's filming me saying, it won't turn on. Put your foot on the brake, Mr. Noe.
But he said it.
Good
luck, Dylan.
Okay. Diane gave me some...
Please stay in the front seat, will you?
Okay.
Huh?
Diane gave me money in case I need a locksmith. Yeah, but it only is the shell.
Wait, it only works
except for our counselor.
Yeah, I have a B of A.
They must drive.
Okay, I'm gonna practice driving around. You guys, would you look behind me and tell me if it's okay?
Okay,
I'm gonna drive around just to get the feel of it.
Stop.
Okay.
No, you're fine. Pick it up on the curb.
Oh, these vans are so great. Small and fresh.
Yeah.
What did I do? Have you guys been in these vans before?
Yeah. I take it for softball.
Yeah, tennis all the time.
This is pretty easy.
Yeah.
Why didn't you ask me to get out of the day? That was fine.
I like the dance.
What, Jane? That's super, Jane.
Well, don't you think we should do the don't you think we should do the Normandy scene?
Yeah.
I don't know.
Stupid writer. I love that line. Stupid writer. Isn't that what he says?
Words?
Yeah.
It's not nice to fit four people in the back seat.
There's so much hair!
Especially when they're shedding.
Hi, Maria.
Hi.
Hi, Dylan.
Hi, Dylan!
Right.
Amber, save that for
he doesn't want you touching us anymore.
What was that, DJ?
By Antonin Dvorak.
Oh,
I want to film this.
Well, let's talk. I just want to get out of the car.
Okay, we're just going to stop for a couple seconds. Go to the bathroom or anything. Sorry, I screwed up. show was that?
That's good. We'll grab some 40s, Leanna. Okay, go, Neil.
Okay,
here.
How about just go like this?
Yeah.
Good job.
I did drop the cleaner.
I wish it
Let's see the love kit.
Love kit? Love kit. Exotic tingling condom.
It's upside down.
Great. Good. Woohoo! Sweet.
Yeah,
all right.
Yeah, yeah.
20 football recruits.
Okay.
It's not too late.
But when we get back, oh, here it is. Over there.
Sounds like turning into a reservoir.
McCoy going out tap.
You only have 15 minutes.
So sucks to eat.
You're a pretty good eater, Neil. Yeah. I would have cracked under the pressure.
Big daddies.
Big daddies.
Big daddies.
I could do the first part.
Neil will tell you about it. You can't let him know. You get. I
want. That's alright. Jesus, Jane.
We have 14 minutes of footage left, and then I'm gonna start taping over rehearsal.
Yeah.
It's my favorite part of the job.
Anyway, Jenica, you would definitely like this guy. We're sitting there, and he's all sitting
there.
Okay.
Oh, it's not focusing, Jane. Focus, there it is. Oh, that's really scary. No, don't touch it, don't touch it. You threw off the focus.
No, you getting it?
No, it's out of focus.
How'd it get down there?
Magic.
My name is Reynolds, Lewis Reynolds.
Mine's English, Janice English.
Oh, English.
I have what everyone else had.
Okay.
What?
This is going to be a very well documented trip.
You guys have to.
There's nobody behind us, besides Ron.
I'm going the wrong way, you guys.
Then turn and go the other way. There's nobody coming.
You sure?
Yes, I'm positive.
Go.
Go, Miss Ren.
Go like the wind.
I see us, yes, like, what the hell?
I don't know where I am.
Just keep.
Look at this. Museums are all torn.
I'm leaving. Don't you say that.
Listen, Steph, I'm serious. I cannot write anymore. I used to put out some great stuff, but now.
You're just being pretentious.
Pretentious.
Barry, you're one of the most talented guys I know. But your best stuff comes when you don't try so hard. Oh, your poems are some of the most beautiful I've ever
poems?
Heard.
Poems? Poems to cry at. I want to sit in the back row of my play. Poems are hollow. Can't explain.
Barry, people know when a writer is lying. Write about something you know. Write about something that's true.
You want true? Watch Wild Kingdom. This is the theater.
But you have so much in your life.
I have nothing. I'm boring. This world is boring.